Good evening and very welcome everyone. Thank you for sparing your time. I really, really appreciate your being here today, sparing the time for this after a whole working day. It's really, really appreciable. We understand the challenges that the schools and educators face in keeping abreast with the length and the breadth and the depth of the latest of technology. Therefore, we at the Pedagogics have taken this task as a team to help you address these challenges, and we're bringing to you a weekly dose of 30-minute webinar or an online meeting so that we can keep you updated with whatever's happening around the world. We will be sharing many, many insights with you, and today is our first Tech Talk Tuesday, as we very fondly call it, and we are going to talk about digital civility today. I think navigating the online world can be a bit of a minefield, even for us as adults. So when it comes to teaching the next generation how to survive in the technology-driven society, it can be difficult to know just where to begin. Therefore, we feel that one of the challenges, and in fact an important priority for K-12 today, is to broaden our understanding of what it means to be a digital citizen. So here we are talking about young people and producers as producers and managers of information and perspectives, and not simply people we need to keep safe and civil. With that thought in mind, we begin today's webinar. I'm Meenakshi Oberoi, education evangelist and founding director of Deep Pedagogics. That's my Twitter handle at Meenakshi Oberoi. You can find us on a Twitter, email, you can email us for anything that you would like us to interact with further. And you can, of course, find us on Facebook. We have an exclusive page over there. With me is Shelly Sachdev. Shelly, I'll hand it over to you for you to introduce yourself.
Thank you so very much, Meenakshi, for introducing the webinar series and beautifully setting the tone of this webinar today. My name is Shelly Sachdev, and I'm a consultant and workshop leader working with Deepika Gautam. And we are here today for a webinar series. Is my voice echoing, Meenakshi?
Little bit of disturbance is there along with, but that's all right. Before we move forward into what digital civility is and Shelly takes over, I just want to bring one thing to your notice, that we have a chat window running. We will be saying a hi, hello, and chatting along with you. Please post your comments, your questions, worries, anything that you have done in the field of digital civility with your students. Please do not hesitate to share. We appreciate your sharing here. There are certain PDFs that we have put as our content today for you. Those are ready referrals for you. Those are your takeaways. You may feel free to download those along with a PowerPoint which we are using to present today. Also, to keep you active, we have certain surprises in between. So just stay active and we'll take you on a good journey today for the next 30 minutes.
Thank you, Meenakshi. So before I actually define what digital civility is all about, I think I would like to throw some light on the kind of identities that we adults are portraying in a technology-driven society and in the digital era that we are living in. I think all of us here present today would agree that all adults and everybody who's online these days, we possess two identities. We have a personal or a real identity, and we have a digital identity. And usually what happens is that our habits define us. But ask yourself that how true is this for our digital habits? Can you say that are we the same people online as offline? So if I talk about the early days of the internet, I think it was probably safe to assume that our online behaviors did not reveal much about our real world identities or personas. But I think now, as the internet has gained prominence in our lives, we have given up completely on anonymity, and also even the desire to mask our real identities online. So indeed, you know, the online activities are no longer separable from our real lives, but have become an integral part of it. So if I share some interesting statistics with you, so an average millennial aged 16 to 30 years in India is spending about 2.2 hours a day, which is roughly about 34 days of a year on their mobile devices, be it doing Facebook, Snapchat, WhatsApp, etc. It could be anything. So these days, when our real identity and online identities are literally colliding or coexisting, it's extremely important that we understand some common etiquettes of conversing online. And I think more than us adults, it's the students who need to understand, because young people are continuously online, even in school. So it's important for schools and parents and teachers to consider the implications of their online activity. We can't, you know, really give students a device and tell them how to use it without having a deeper conversation first about how they use a device to communicate with the world. Right? So digital civility is exactly about teaching them, empowering them to act with empathy and compassion, and to also appreciate cultural differences and diverse perspectives. As 21st century educators, I'm very sure you must have done a lot of Skype conferences with other schools. I'm sure that as educators, you always, sensitize your children on how to speak to the other culture, how to respect the other cultures and the diverse perspectives that exist. So that's exactly digital civility. When you are teaching children about being positive, compassionate, and empathetic about other people. And there are a lot of other dimensions that Meenakshi and I are going to share about in this webinar.
Sure. Before I move forward, I think I see a lot of echoing being reported in the chat window. Shelley, till I take on the next slide, would you please check on the settings if possible?
Yeah, let me just check, because here it seems all right. I'm not. Should I just give me a minute? I'll just log out and log in once again.
Sure. Till then, let's keep talking about what are the form of digital engagements that we come across. We use media to inform ourselves, to help shape our opinions, to interact and within our communities, and to make our voices heard. Models of digital citizenship are generally framed around elements such as rights and responsibilities, participation or civic engagement, norms of behavior or etiquettes, and a sense of belonging and membership. What we look at is that our students are capable users of ICT, they promote civility and respect, and are responsible and ethical. All the things that are right in front of you is what we expect our students to be and to do while they are browsing the World Wide Web. While we do so, and while we wait for Shelley to come back, like I said, let me engage you in somewhat interesting ways. I'm just going to make my poll active for you. I need you to use your fastest finger first and help me answer this poll. And the poll should be visible to you now. Can you see it? Anyone can say yes in the chat window and I'll know. Oh, you can't see it? Not yet? Okay. I can see people taking the poll, so I know that people have logged in. And poll is open. Can you take the poll now? Okay. Can you now? Oh, yeah, so Shefali, you've done it. Because I can see people responding to the poll. I can so see it. Oh, yes, excellent. I'll give it another minute for everyone to just... Oh, you're using a mobile. That's all right. If we could just request the rest of you to please take the poll. Oh, teach you how I did it. Super simple. Yes. You just have to pull up your window. This window will have an option of more. When you click on more, you get these three options which says whiteboard, poll, and question and answer. You click on poll and you could use the polling option. You pre-make these polls and keep them ready, and then go to manage contents to make them alive. But that's almost my first time too. So yes, thank you. For you, can you see the results? Yes, you are able to see the results. If you look at the results, what we have in front of is, what is the greatest benefit the internet has brought to your life? So The options are entertainment, learning, socializing, commercial activities, and others. And what is not surprising to me is that because we all are educators here, the most popular answer is learning. Well, I'm amazed to see that it is learning, because if I were you, I would put it as socializing, because that's what I started using internet for. Great to see these responses, and I hope you've enjoyed this poll. Let's get back to our presentation, and Shelley's back too.
Yeah, thank you so much. Am I audible, Meenakshi? And I hope there's no echo.
Yes, you are audible, very much audible. I hope there's no echoing of the voice. Is there any echoing? Oh yeah, social me. Thank you, Amita. You know me so well. All right, let's move on. We've done the poll and the stage is all yours.
Okay, thank you. So I'm going to talk a little about Digital Civility Index. I think there is a little echo, Meenakshi. I don't know how to actually clear this out.
I think it's fine. Okay. If you can put your phone away from your device, maybe that'll help. And I'm going to do that the same thing. So maybe that helps. So just go on. It's all right. I can hear you. People say that they can hear you too.
Okay, great. So I think talking about the Digital Civility Index, taking the discussion forward, I just wanted to share with you that Microsoft had conducted research among adults and teenagers in 14 countries to study the level of civility across various online interactions. So this was a very interesting study conducted by Microsoft, and they had started this to promote safer internet on the Safer Internet Day in February sometime. And basically this DCI, or Digital Civility Index, it measures consumers' lifetime exposure to online risks. So you know what they did? They divided online risks into four categories: behavioral, intrusive, reputational, and sexual. So each category consisted of several individual risks, and based on these categories, these surveys were conducted in these 14 countries. So basically, lower scores of DCI equate to lower online risk exposure and a higher digital civility index. So even the results were extremely interesting, and in these 14 countries, and Meenakshi will share with you the interesting results in these 14 countries by way of statistics and figures, and it'll be very interesting to see where our country is placed in terms of the DCI. Meenakshi?
Oh, sorry. So here's the index in front of you, the results. India is at about 63%. And it's always a pleasure to see that, you're somewhere in the middle, not so bad and not so good. On a scale of 0% being civil and 100% being uncivil, and the shades being turning from the sea blue to the sea green, what we can see is, yes, it's really brings a smile to my face too when we see this, because Microsoft conducted this research amongst adults and teenagers, which was surprising for me, in 14 countries to study the level of civility across various online interactions. These results expand on the behavioral component of the Microsoft's Computer Safety Index by examining the extent of negative civil and personal safety interactions and their consequences. So therefore, definitely this is a breezer for us to see that we are not doing bad, but then we can always be there on the 0% side rather than being on the 63% side. More insights for you from Shelley.
Yeah, I think we've seen country-wise statistics, and I would like to share the international statistics where, internationally, the summary of it, of all of this research, was that 65% of adults and youth aged 13 to 17 reported having ever been exposed to an online risk. So if I actually, based on this research, put the four categories in the order of, highest online risk, the intrusive category was the major highest incidence of any individual risk, followed by behavioral, then sexual, and then reputational. So many of the people, like 43% of people, said that unwanted contact was the main driver of intrusive risk. And 39% of people said that behavioral risks were the second most common category, which was the risk category. and followed by sexual, where they said that unwanted sexting and sexual solicitation consumed around 30% of this data. And the last being the reputational risk, where people said that they have encountered doxing and, publishing of their secret data and all of that online. So this was the order of the four online risk categories.
Scary, isn't it? But that's not the idea behind sharing all these statistics with you. What we would appreciate is if you could look at this, we could just wake up to do something about it. There are so many elements to digital citizenship, and we could just work on one. And the one that we're working on today is digital civility. But there are certain alarming facts which somewhere we know at the back of our mind, but we do not really realize what it is. For that, let me bring to perspective many more things, and ask you to take another poll. Here's your poll. The poll is now active. Let me know if you can see. Please give me an answer in the chat window to know if you can see. The question here is, one third of the kids ages 12 to 17 send more than dash texts each day. So how many texts each day do you think these children aged between 12 to 17 send? And the best guess possible, what I can see from the poll is 75. And the correct answer is 100. Isn't it scary? Isn't it scary to even understand or try and understand that about 100 of texts are sent by each day by these children in this age group? The whole language of what they speak, the way they share is changing. Somewhere, I feel that we are equally responsible and we need to bring in civility in the digital world. We need to teach to them how to interact, because that is also a reflection of the teacher in the school that they visit. Yes, it is very, very scary, Mrs. Dillon. It is. And this is why we are here talking about digital civility. Digital civility to me is nothing very big, but just being civil, being nice, being polite, being respectful. And of course, with the research and the kind of data that we have, we have certain statistics available to us which help us understand. You're unable to hear me? Yeah, okay. Thank you. My voice is very clear. Thank you. So, yeah, the presentation is still loading. So, I'll await the presentation to load. But till then, I'll keep talking to you. So, there are certain encouraging things that we can ask, or we can encourage our children to do. One is live the golden rule by acting with empathy, compassion, and kindness in every interaction. Whether they're saying a hi or a hello, or as small as just saying goodbye or signing off, or the kind of language that our children are using. I really cannot be bringing that into our webinar. And treating everyone they connect with online with dignity and respect. Number two, respect differences and honor diverse perspectives. And when disagreements surface, to engage thoughtfully and avoid name-calling and personal attacks. All of these things that I'm talking about are so prevalent around us, but we feel that this is outside of our school. But we must never forget that all these things are a reflection of not only the way children are being brought up or the way environment in which they are living, and school is plays a major role in this, as the language that is being taught, normally what we hear from parents is it all comes from school. Therefore, here we are, teachers, who need to take charge of and take control and show them direction of to follow the correct path. Number three, pause before replying. Well, that's something I think half of you would have laughed it off, because asking for our students to really think or pause before replying is like asking for a little too much. I'm going to hold on to these two thoughts. Or I'm just going to complete this thought maybe, because this slide was a little later, but since we were waiting for slides to come up, I took this chance of talking to you about this. Pausing before replying to things people disagree with, and not posting or sending anything that could hurt someone else. damage reputations, or threaten people's safety. These are a few things. If we talk to them, I'm sure they'll be aware and they'll be conscious, and I'm sure doing it next time they would be much more aware not to or to do the right thing. Stand up for myself and others by supporting those who are targets online or abuse or cruelty, or reporting these activities that threaten anyone's safety, on preserving evidence of inappropriate and unsafe behavior. Because the moment we see an unsafe behavior or an unsafe post, what the normal instinct for anyone is, just delete it. But don't delete it, that's your evidence. So we need to bring into perspective how to deal with these problems, how to go